Most out ports, you know the kind, I'm sure. Cigarettes in his pocket, still he'll ask for one of yours. If he's getting short of linnet, well, you better guard your store. A carefree, easy-going man, but a no-good hand, sure.
I suppose you're wondering where you are. Well, you're in Pigeon Inlet. Well, that's Bird Island we just come past out there. And that's Lodge Bartle's house, biggest in the harbour. And up there among them trees is a schoolhouse. Only today it's not being used as a schoolhouse. It's being used as a courtroom.
That's what this chair is for.
For the magistrate? Well, I mean, you gotta have something decent for an important man like that. So I borrowed this one from my mother and lugged it over. The case before the court today is been the talk of this chair for the past 3 months. It's a case of theft. Well, I suppose you could call it theft. There's been a spat of confusion about it. Anyway, theft is a charge against the defendant. And everybody is here to see how it all turns out. I'm Eli Whitten, and I'm here today as clerk of the court. Well, I'm getting paid $3 a day for it, too. Well, that's not bad, is it? Oh, you see that man down there? That's Skipper Bob Kettle, the magistrate, a fair and just man. Huh, one of the most respected all up and down the coast. He'll see to it that justice is done here today. Lodge!
Hello, Eli. Nice to see you.
How are you?
Eli. That's Lodge Bradle, the finer man is in the harbour. He's the plaintiff in the case. He's the one that's named the charge of theft. And there's the defendant, the one accused of theft, Uncle Solomon Nally. He's the one they calls the hang-ashore. A hang-ashore is a per... Oh, I guess the best way to describe a hang-ashore... You know, I don't believe I can describe a hang-ashore. Oh, Grandpa! Well, that's Grandpa Walcott. Grandpa, tell them what a hang-ashore is.
Well, if you want to know, I'll tell you. Uncle Solomon Nutty is as a hang-ashore if ever there was one. By that I mean, he's too bad to be called a good-for-nothing, and not bad enough to be called a sleeve-in. He's just a hang-ashore. You see, a good-for-nothing might be no good in one place, but turn out all right in some other place. Like young Simon Briggs, who was home on the holidays. He used to get seasick, almost die, every time they took him out to help haul the country.
His father?
Poor Skipper Tight Briggs used to say that Simon was a waste of patience and good grub. But where is he now? He's a clergyman up in Toronto, in one of the biggest churches they got up there. And then take over Di Miller, a good-for-nothing. He's in his 70s, but still people come to him from all up and down the shore to get him to charm away the tooth. And he can put away watch, too, just by counting them. And as for Slee Beans, look at Almighty Belcher. But that's another story that you probably haven't got time for now. Anyway, I'm not pretending that Uncle Solomon Nutty is as bad as Almighty Belcher. He's just a hang-ashore, no more, no less. But it's his thievery that got this court work here today. And court work is a thing that no self-respectable settlement likes. So this is why we're all here today. We're waiting to see Solomon Nutty get his comeuppance.
Oh, no, Mrs. Antler, you're not here, too, are you? How much can I suffer in one day?
My knitting.
Solomon, move away from me, will you? Order now. Order. Mrs. Antle, try to restrain yourself. We've got a lot of work to do. This court is in session to try the case of Elijah Bartle versus Solomon Noddy. And being as how the price of fish is what it is this year, we'll call this a pauper's case, which means there'll be no court charges no matter how it comes out. Pass me my gavel in the case there, he'll look a good boy. Now, you, Solomon Noddy, are charged with stealing the property of Elijah Bartle, to wit, two holes in the ice. How do you plead, guilty or not guilty?
Skipper Bob!
Order! You address Your Honor as Your Honor.
Sorry, Skipper Bob, I ain't never been in court before. Well, Your Honor, I say not guilty. And I'd like to wait and hear Elijah Bartle's side of the story and then ask some questions.
Yes, Uncle Sol, you can do that. That's your right as a British subject.
You mean a British object?
Now, Grandpa, you set her off again. Try to keep a civil tongue, will you? Because this is a serious case.
Sorry, Your Honor.
All right. Now, Lodge, the plaintiff goes first and the defendant comes after. Now, the defendant today pleads not guilty, so it's time to call your first witness and start your case.
Well, Skipper Bob, I mean, Your Honor, I guess the best one for me to start off with would be the wife.
Mrs. Bartle, take the stand, please. Swear the witness in, Eli.
Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help me God?
I do.
Now, Suze, my dear, tell your name, who you are, where you live, and then kiss the book.
Susanna Mildred Bartle. I'm Lodge Bartle's wife, and we live in the second house in from the point.
All right, Lodge, your witness is sworn. You can start your questions.
Now, Suze, my love, how did this whole business start off?
'Twas 3 months ago. More than that. 'Twas early in March month, and this is almost the middle of June. 'Twas the 3rd or 4th of March.
All right, now tell us what happened on the 3rd of March.
No, it wasn't. It was the 4th. I remember now, because the 3rd was a Tuesday. That was the day Alice Gilbert had twins.
All right, Lodge. We'll call it the 4th. Now find out what happened on the 4th of March.
Well, we got up at 6:30, and you wanted pancakes.
Not the whole day, woman. Begin at the part where I came home from rabbit catching. What did I say when I came in through the door?
You said, get me a pair of dry cuffs. I'm in a hurry. And I said, never mind your dry cuffs. Now eat your dinner. And you said, I haven't got time. And I said, get any rabbits? And you said, only a brace. And I said, your dinner is in the oven and you got to eat it. And you were supposed to be home 2 hours ago and I was worried to death in case you were after falling through the ice. And you said...
Just a moment, please. Suze, my dear, I don't want you to take this the wrong way, but there's no need to go into so much detail.
My goodness, Your Honor, I'm sorry.
The funny thing about it, Your Honor, she was just coming to the important part.
I was?
Yes, when I came home, you asked me why I was so late. What did I tell you?
Oh, yes. You said you stopped on your way down the inlet to cut some holes in the ice so you could put out some herring net and get some herring for the dogs.
That's right, Skipper Bob. I mean, Your Honor. And it took me some long time to cut them holes. The ice was almost 2 feet thick.
And that's why he wanted the dry cuffs, Your Honor. He wanted to get back and put the nets in and be home again before dark.
And what did you say then, Suze?
I said, Lige, wait till tomorrow and go and put the nets in.
Now we're coming to it, Your Honor. And what did I say then, Suze?
You said no, girl, you said. The hole's liable to get covered in with snow during the night. Right, and that's someone else liable to see him there with no nets in him and take him over for himself.
That's right, Your Honor. That's what I said. Those were me very words.
And I said, what? I said, sure, no one to do the like of that, would they? Take it on a man's holes. You know, that he worked so hard to cut. Sure, for someone to do the like of that, he'd have to be a hang-a-sure.
Yes, Your Honor, and a hang-a-sure he is. And he's right here in your court. He's sitting right over there, Solomon Nye.
Order now, order. Now, be quiet, the whole lot of you.
We're here in this court today to get to the facts of the matter and see that justice is done, not to go shouting and bawling at each other. Now, Lige, I have to warn you, another outburst like that and I'll find you in contempt of court.
I'm sorry, Your Honor. I lost me heed.
All right, your apology is accepted, but don't lose it like that anymore. Now, are you ready to continue with your case?
Yes, Your Honor. I'm ready. Ready for another witness.
All right, Suze, my dear. You're excused. You can go back to your seat.
Don't you want to hear about the babies?
I do.
Oh.
Now, Lodge, your next witness.
I call the prisoner, Solomon Noddy.
He's not the prisoner, Lige. He's the defendant.
Sure's the same thing, ain't it?
No, it's not the same thing, Lige. Now, don't call him the prisoner.
I call the guilty party, Solomon Noddy.
Now, do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, and God help you? So help me God.
Now, Uncle Sol, state your name, what you do, where you live, say I do, and kiss the book.
My name is Solomon Noddy. I'm a fisherman. I lives in the greenhouse just inside of the bridge. I do.
Mm. All right, Lodge, your witness is properly sworn.
Now, Solomon Noddy, you kissed the book, so you got to tell the truth.
Me tell the truth? I'll tell the truth, all right. You're the one that I'm worried about, not telling the truth.
Now, look, you'll both tell the truth, or I'll have the two of you up on a charge of perjury. Now, get on with it.
Yes, Your Honor. Now, Uncle Sol, you remember that day we were talking about a short time ago? March the 4th?
I do. I remember it perfect.
Well, when I came back down from the house, I went to visit the Holmes, and you were there. And you had your neck set in my holes.
And you bawled at me like a savage. What are you doing, you said? Get that net out of them holes, you said.
I suppose I did. You had your net set in my holes.
What do you mean, your holes? They were my holes. I found them.
You found them. I don't care who you found them. I caught them.
Yes, that's what you told me that day, too. You said you were the one that caught them.
Yes, Your Honor. I caught them that very afternoon.
So you were the one that caught.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Now, you two fellas seem to be agreed on the facts of the matter. Lige cut the holes. Uncle Sol put his net in them. And then what happened?
Yes, Your Honor. Since I cut the holes, I told Uncle Sol I was going to put my hair net in them.
And, Your Honor, I told Lige that I didn't see how he was going to do that because there's not room for two hair nets in the same two holes.
Yes, sir, and I told him if he didn't take his hair net out, I would.
And I told him that he'd better not do that because that hair net was my property, see? And the law don't hold with a man interfering with another man's property.
Your property? What about my property?
My property?
The holes, they were mine.
Holes, holes. How can holes be anybody's property? They were nobody's holes when I found them, and how was I supposed to know who caught them? And anyway, how could they be your holes when I had me net in them?
Look at here, Uncle Sol. Do you know what I believe? I believe you watched me cut those holes, and you deliberately waited until all that hard work was finished. Then you went out and claimed them for yourself, just to avoid the trouble of going and cutting your own holes. That's what I believe, you lazy hangashar.
Order, order, order. Mrs. Antle, be quiet. Now, Lige, there you go with that hard talk again. I warned you about that before.
I'm sorry, Your Honor. I won't do it again.
Well, see that you don't. Now, are you ready for another witness? Have you finished your case?
I don't have any more witnesses, so I guess I'm finished, Your Honor.
All right, then you can go back and take your seat. Now, Uncle Sol, you can begin your case.
Okay, Your Honor. But before I do, can I ask a question and have you explain something to me?
Well, that all depends on what you want to know. Is it a clarification of a point of law?
That's what it is, Your Honor. That's exactly what it is.
Very well, then. Go ahead.
Your Honor, just what is the law concerning holes?
The law concerning what?
Concerning holes. Your Honor, what is the law concerning holes?
I see. Law concerning holes. Well, now, Uncle Sol, that's not an easy question to answer. You see, there is no special law concerning holes any more than there's a law about chewing tobacco or a splitting knife or a suit of oilskins.
I see. So there is no law about holes.
No, there's no law about holes. But there is a law about stealing. And that law states that no one shall steal anything from another man. Anything.
Not even a hole.
Not even a hole.
But, Your Honor...
Yes?
How can anybody steal a hole?
Well, what do you mean?
I mean, a hole is nothing. It's just an empty space with nothing in it. So how can anybody steal nothing?
Order, order. Order. Mrs. Antle, that laugh is going to make me clear the court.
Your Honor, Your Honor.
Yes, Lige. What is it?
He says a hole is nothing.
That's what he says.
Well, Your Honor, I'm telling you here and now, he'd soon find out what a hole is if he had to chop on himself instead of stealing somebody else.
Order now. Order. Now, quiet down. This is developing into a serious case. Sues, sit down. Mrs. Antle, put that knitting business back in your bag. Lewis, put away that orange. Now, I have to make a ruling on this, a ruling which, to the best of my ability, is fair and just. Do you understand what I mean?
Yes, I understand, Your Honor. You were always a fair man, Skipper Bob, and I'll abide by whatever you say.
Good, because I'm going to rule that a hole is something. Considering the fact that it took Lige Bartle a long time and a lot of hard work to cut two of them in the ice.
Yes, Skipper Bob. It took 2 hours of hard work.
All right, then. All right. Do you want to say something, Uncle Sol?
Indeed I do, Your Honor. Indeed I do. Where is the evidence?
The evidence?
Yes, Your Honor. Where's the stolen goods? Lige Bartle there said that I stole 2 holes in the ice. And you said a hole is a real thing. So where's the stolen goods? I mean, where are they? Who's got them? I know I certainly haven't got them.
Order now. Order. Now be quiet, everybody. We're coming to the main part of this trial. Lige Bartle approached the bench. Now, the plaintiff has finished his case, so it's time for the defendant to start his. Now, you two fellas change places. That's right. Lige, you go over and sit down where Uncle Sol was too, and Uncle Sol will ask the questions. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help your God? State your name, your business, and your address, and then kiss the book.
My name is Elijah Bartle, fisherman, Pigeon Inlet, 2 houses in from the point.
Kiss the book. All right, Uncle Sol, your witness is properly sworn. Go to it.
Now, Lige Bartle, will you answer me that important question I asked a minute ago? Where's the stolen goods? Where's the 2 holes in the ice you said I stole on? In other words, where's the evidence?
That's right, Mike.
How can I answer a foolish question like that? You know where they are. They're gone.
Gone? Gone where?
Gone where? Gone where? They're gone out to sea. Sure, that was in March I cut those holes. This is June. When the ice went out in the spring and moved off, the holes went with it. Sure, everybody knows that around here.
Sure, we do.
Everybody'd know that except the hang ashore.
Oh, Your Honor, but that is where I beg to differ.
All right, Uncle Sol, explain yourself.
I say, sir, that them holes did not go out to sea. Now, the ice might have gone out to sea, but the holes didn't.
I still don't understand.
Your Honor, you yourself proved that a hole is a real thing. And I respect that judgment, sir.
Them holes are open spaces of water in the inlet. And they're still out there in the inlet, exactly where Lloyd's partly cut them. The only difference is now they don't have any ice around the edges.
That's right, boy. You got it.
Oh, my God. Well, I suppose I'll have to make a ruling on that, too. Well, my ruling is that you can't have holes unless there's edges around them. And the holes we're talking about today are no longer there. Now, for heaven's sake, Uncle Sol, will you proceed along another line of questioning?
Yes. Indeed I will, Your Honor. Indeed I will, no sooner said than done. Let me suggest this to you, sir. Weren't them holes abandoned?
Abandoned? Now, there's a point. Lige, he says the holes were abandoned. What do you say to that?
Abandoned? How could they be abandoned? I didn't even get a chance to use them.
How was I supposed to know that?
Your Honor, anybody could see that they weren't abandoned. You could see that they were fresh cut.
And how could you tell that, Lige?
Because of tobacco stains all around on the ice.
Oh, I see. And were those tobacco stains of a rich, dark brown color?
Yes, sir, they were.
Not faded or washed out looking?
No, Your Honor, right fresh looking.
I see. Well, my ruling on that is that the holes were newly cut and were not abandoned.
Your Honor, Your Honor, I have one more question.
Yes, Uncle Sol, what is it?
Your Honor, can a man steal something if he don't move it from where he found it?
Well, not very well, I suppose.
Well, then that clears me, because I didn't shift them holes 1 inch from where I found them.
Oh. You didn't shift them. You didn't shift them. You know why you didn't shift them? Because you couldn't shift them. If you could have shifted them, you would have taken them out of the water, thrown them over your shoulder, and made off with them.
Your Honor, that's not the point. That's not the point. Whether I didn't shift them holes because I couldn't shift them or because I wouldn't shift them makes no difference at all. The point is, I didn't shift them.
Order now, order. Mrs. Angel, be quiet. All right, then, that concludes both sides of the case. You can go back to your seats. Having heard both sides of the dispute, I will now sum up before handing down a judgment. Solomon Noddy, the court finds that what you did was wrong. However, you didn't steal the holes. You used them without having any right to do so. Therefore, you are not guilty of a theft. You are guilty of a trespass. And since there are no court charges involved, we'll finish up this case right now and say, Solomon Noddy, you are guilty of a trespass against Lige Bartle. Do you have anything to say for yourself?
A trespass, Your Honor. Is that what it is?
Yes, that's what it is.
Well, then, 'tis over. And I'm free to go with no punishment.
Wait a minute. What makes you think that?
Well, now, Lige Bartle there is an honest, God-fearing man. Why, he just lives by the good book. So I'm quite sure that he'll forgive them that trespass against him.
Will you do that, Lige?
Will I do what, Your Honor?
Forgive Uncle Sol who trespassed against you.
Oh, indeed I will. Indeed I will. Just as soon as he pays me for damages.
You can't get damages from a fellow that can't pay any more than you can get blood from a donor.
That may very well be true, Uncle Sol, but there are certain damages that you can pay. Solomon Noddy, it is the sentence of this court that you cut 2 holes in the ice for Lige Bartle next winter in exactly the same place.
I got to cut 2 holes in the ice for that, for Lige Bartle next winter. Is that it?
Yes, that's your sentence. Court is adjourned.
Your Honor! Your Honor! Your Honor!
Yes, Uncle Sol, what is it?
Your Honor, can I
Now lay a charge against Lige Bartle.
What?
A charge against Lige? What for?
Libel.
Libel?
He called me a hangashore, and I'd like to have a trial on that right now, sir, before you takes the boat out of Pigeon Inlet.
Well, I've heard the charge, and I'll make a ruling right now on Lige Bartle calling you a hangashore. I'll say the charge is dismissed, and this court is adjourned because, well, he might say it. That's what you are, a hangashore.
I suppose you were still wondering what a hangashore really is. Perhaps it's something like young Wilson Green. I was lining me picket fence last week, and I was feeling a bit tired when he came by. And I said, Wilson, how much would you charge to finish this fence for me? Grandpa, he said, I'd finish that fence for you for nothing. You would, said I. Yes, he said, if I was going to do it, I'd do it for nothing. But I'm not going to do it. I'm going to go and catch a few trout. Now, that's a hangashore.
Now, the scripture says, in being a man, put away your childish deeds. But a man of slippery notions seldom lives by holy creed. You'll find him in Vancouver, and he's walking down on Bloor. But here in Newfoundland, he's called a true blue hangashore. Yes, here in Newfoundland, he's called a true blue hangashore.